This is the Road to Paris 2024, brought to you from the ISSF, and you are very welcome here. I'm Jamie Stangroom.
And I'm Martina Lucic, and we're counting down to the Paris Games by celebrating all of the Olympic shooting disciplines with the champions of the past, present, and future.
But you knew that, right? Because you've been watching religiously so far, haven't you? Good. This episode, we turn our attention to the trap men's event. Martina, how does it work?
That's right, Jamie. As you said, in this episode, we delve into the rich heritage of trap men's event. The origins of trap shooting dates all the way back to the 18th century. Shooting with a 12-gauge shotgun, in this event, athletes shoot at clay targets ejected in scheme-decided varying angles and heights from trap machines located right in front of them. The athletes call upon the targets by making a sound, usually yelling out, "Pull." There are five stations lined up next to each other, with athletes moving from one station to the next after each shot. Accuracy, focus, and swift reactions are essential as these skilled marksmen compete firstly in qualification, shooting 125 targets, to later step onto the main final range and measure out their forces, shooting down additional 50 targets. The elimination process of the six finalists starts after 25 targets and continues after each five. The two last standing men decide on the gold, shooting down 10 more targets. In the past Olympic events, a very popular variation of the trap men event was called double trap. As the event itself says, instead of one target flying out, two targets are released simultaneously, thrown from different trap machines at varying angles and heights, with the goal being hitting both targets with two shots instead of one. Today, trap has become one of the most popular shooting sport events, showcasing exceptional athletes as they skillfully take down targets from the sky.
Thank you, Martina. Very good. I think I got that. So, who should we be looking out for in Paris?
Oh, well, honestly, I don't really pick and choose my favorites, and I don't want to do that, but this time I'm going to make an exception and go with Croatia's Giovanni Crnogorac.
Biased.
Well, yeah, okay, I'm Croatian as well, but Jamie, he's currently the top number one in the world. He's the 2012 Olympic champion, he's the world champion, Europe's champion. The fact that he's from my country is just an addition, a bonus to this whole thing. Of course, there's so many other names out there, including Jamie, one of our guests in this episode.
Okay, fair enough. You're off the hook. And yes, coming up, we do have three interviews. We'll be hearing from two-time Olympic medalist Russel, Tokyo 2020 bronze medalist Matthew Coward-Holley, who I think Martina was referring to there. But first, Australia's double Olympic champion Michael Diamond takes us on a little stroll down Olympic memory lane.
The Olympic Games in 92 being my first event was a great experience that any athlete could have, and I'm sure that most athletes would think the same way, is that the experience that I derived from the Barcelona Games was shot me into stardom, more or less. It was the building blocks and essence for my future in the sport of clay shooting. I was only a very young, just out of my teens, 20-year-old at that point in time. And so for a 20-year-old to qualify for the Olympic Games, I think, in Australia was unheard of. Most of the people that qualified for the Games prior, they were a lot older. So in itself, it was a milestone. Yeah, so 4 years later down the track, we had the World Cup events up under our belt. I'd won a gold medal in Korea. I'd won a couple of bronze medals, and that sort of started gaining my confidence as a competitor in the open field. And obviously heading into Atlanta in 1996 at the Olympics, I knew more to what to expect, and I came prepared, you know, managing to be able to win my first Olympic gold medal in 1996. What a great achievement. Going into Sydney, you know, being a home favourite, a lot of expectations, and also managing to deliver the expectations to the crowd and to the locals, winning my second Olympic consecutive gold medal. Well, will all of a sudden clay target shooting in Australia become socially acceptable? It was acceptable to run a corporate day. It was acceptable to have somebody come in off the street and sign a P56 form and enjoy our sport. Whereas prior to that, we never really had that. And it was so refreshing to see that our sport had levitated to the stars, particularly in Australia. Embrace it. And whatever you are feeling, enjoy it. No matter whether it's competition pressure or the awe of being in the same room as the people that are walking and rubbing shoulders beside you, this is truly an experience to take to your heaven. I have thoroughly enjoyed my experience. However, my experience is not over yet.
That was double Olympic champion Michael Diamond from Australia, now part of the Qatar shooting team.
Coming up next, a trap shooter who will be hoping to go to Paris and build up on the bronze he picked up 3 years ago in Tokyo. ISSF TV's Rory McAllister caught up with Great Britain's Matthew Coward-Holley for us and started by asking him about the rugby injury that inadvertently led to his Olympic shooting career.
It was a long one for me. I shot when I was very, very young. I was desperate to pursue a career in rugby, absolutely desperate. Injury very much got in the way of that. A couple of broken backs here and there. Then I went on and carried on shooting and obviously progressed through the Olympic disciplines and obviously sat here now as an Olympic bronze medalist.
Yeah, now you've glossed over that a little bit, but just going back, so you were shooting at weekends with your with your dad, just purely just for fun.
When I was very, very young, sort of like 8, 9 years old was when I started with dad, so.
That's young though, to be handling
Yeah, but I was never a small child, so I was more than capable of shooting anything at that age, so.
And even around that time when you're shooting at 8 or 9 years old, you know, were people saying, oh, you know, he's good?
I don't know. It's difficult at that age because you're just out there for fun, spend time with your parents or whoever you're out there with. So a lot of it was just spending time with dad and being out and about on a Sunday and just enjoying the moment more than anything. You don't necessarily think of it at that age that it could take you as far as it has taken myself.
So then in terms of rugby, just before we move on to your professional shooting career, so you're a promising rugby player at around 15 years old. You get a knee injury, you work your way down the teams, come back again.
Yep.
And then,
I came off a knee injury, was working down a few teams at school just to kind of get my fitness back up, ready to play sort of top team school rugby again. Had a incident in training, someone moved a tackle bag out the way. I was committed and hit the deck a bit funny. And that was the first incident. I cracked a vertebrae and slipped a disc. So that was 18 months out. Start all over again, get fit again. I had the 18 months off, got back up to a reasonable enough standard to start playing again. I then had about 6 or 8 months of playing good high level sort of club and school stuff again. And then the second time I was tackled and someone fell across my legs. I've gone to put the ball behind and someone's ran into the back of my shoulders and basically twisted me in two. So that was then the end of my rugby career.
Yes.
So like I said, I'm very fortunate to be not in a wheelchair or with sort of surgeries and pins and whatever else. So I'm very fortunate in that respect.
Yeah, so you're told you're never going to play rugby again.
Yep.
So when does the idea of shooting then come into your mind? Because, you know, you spent about a week in hospital.
Yep.
You're recovering, trying to get back to it.
Yes.
I mean, was sport even on your mind?
Not really, no. I lost all competitive edge. Like, in any inclination to want to compete had gone completely. It was very strange. So I kind of spent 18 months, mixture of recovering mentally and physically. And then I kind of had like a little competitive scratch sort of starts niggling in me. And I wanted to compete again. I wanted to be competitive in something. And with the injuries I had, shooting was an obvious one. I had done it before. There was reasonably good access to it where I lived. So me and dad kind of said, right, let's give it a go. I wanted to just focus on one discipline and get very good at it. So I chose a domestic discipline called Down the Line because I had very good access to it. And then we had a ground just down the road from us, an old England shooter ran it. He took me under his wing and I got very good very quickly at that. Made the junior team within my first couple of years of trying. So still obviously very young. I then went on to win just about everything as a junior in that and won a fair amount as a senior as well, which gave me a very good sort of background in competing again. And then went on to Olympic stuff thereafter.
So the Olympics,
yes.
Tokyo, 2020, yep. It didn't happen till 2021. No. We were both there.
Yeah.
And it was a very strange occasion because we were in the middle of a global pandemic.
Yep.
It was COVID.
Yeah.
And we all didn't get the experience perhaps that we should have.
Agreed. No, I think, don't get me wrong, I think they did a fantastic job of hosting it as well as they did. The atmosphere was as good as it could have been. A lot of us obviously didn't experience the opening ceremony and stuff through the risk. We were doing tests every day. And no one wanted to run the risk of not competing after having got that far. But I will admit, it was a first games for me. And I think it was a very strange first games.
You ended up being GB Shooting's only shooting medal.
Yes.
And I remember very privileged actually being one of the first to speak to you.
Yep.
When you took the bronze medal, how did that feel at the time?
I was very mixed. I went into the Olympics, in my opinion and quite a few others' opinions, favourite to win. I was world champion, European champion, world number one. I went in odds favourite to win it. And as much as I was happy with bronze, I was also very disappointed at the time. I remember sitting there completely, a little bit, I don't know, lifeless is not the right word, but mixed. I wanted to be elated, but I couldn't be. It was very strange because I felt I was shooting well enough and I made a few silly mistakes in the final with it being my first Olympic final. Not that I let them sort of moment get to me. It's just you do have that little bit of inkling of realisation. And I must admit, through qualification, I was quite relaxed. And it wasn't until I sat in the final and you got the announcers, the TV, and I kind of stood there and I looked up at the grandstand. I was a bit like, okay, we're in an Olympic final now. And I felt nerves I'd never felt before.
Because they were huge stands,
weren't they? Obviously, I mean, regardless of them being empty, you look at them and they're an impressive sight to see. And it was kind of like, okay, wow, I'm actually in an Olympic final now. And I felt stuff I'd never felt before in my life. So that was very, very odd. I shot a pretty good final, if I'm honest. I made a few silly mistakes here and there, which cost me. But we'll scratch that down to experience and I won't be doing it again.
In terms of looking ahead then to Paris and the Olympic Games, you're disappointed with your bronze medal. But at the same time, I get that you're not wishing to sound that ungrateful. But are we due an upgrade then in Paris?
We're due an upgrade, 100%. For me, that would be the absolute pinnacle. I think, don't get me wrong, for me, for any sportsman, a gold medal at the Olympics is the pinnacle of what there is to win. I think everybody wants to, but for me, it'd just be the icing on the cake.
Well, we wish you all the best your road to Paris.
Thank you very much.
You know, as a fellow Brit as well, it would be nice to see you go silver, if not gold.
Exactly.
So, Matt Coward-Holley, thank you very much.
You're very welcome. Thank you.
For talking to us.
Thank you.
Matthew Coward-Holley there, talking to our very own Rory McAllister from ISSF TV. So Martina, it was interesting, wasn't it? Matthew talked about his disappointment of taking bronze from the Tokyo Olympics because he went there as world number one, world champion and European champion.
It's what happens, you know, the Olympic Games jitters, I guess. Once you come there, all of the titles, especially if you're at the top of the world, it can sometimes feel like a bit of a pressure. I noticed that I was mentioning Giovanni Cernogoric at the beginning, saying, you know, he has all of these titles. Thankfully, he already does have the gold medal from the Olympics, so maybe a little bit less pressure. But, you know, you can imagine standing there at the finals at the Olympics. I mean, who wouldn't be scared?
Yeah, hopefully you haven't cursed him. But then again, he's already got the Olympic medal.
There you go. It's the same.
Yeah. Okay, so we do have another interview. You spoke to Russel Mark, Tell us about him and what you discussed.
Well, yeah, Jamie, looks like we're driving down memory lane today. So why stop here? I spoke to a double trap Olympic champion of Atlanta Games 1996, Russel Mark, who's pivoted his career into helping others climb the podium by becoming a coach.
I was very lucky in 96. Well, maybe luck's not the right word, but I won that gold medal by 6 points. And for the last 5 minutes of that final, well, the way the finals were set up back in 96, I knew I was going to win. I was so far in front. And it's one of the few times I've ever been at the Olympics and I can say I was actually enjoying while I was competing, because the Olympics, people that say just go and enjoy yourself, that's a stupid thing to say. While you're competing, it's not enjoyable. But when you get 6 points in front in an Olympic final and there's only six shots left, you know you're going to win the gold medal. So Atlanta was very enjoyable because I knew I was going to win. In Sydney, it was close. It went down to a sudden death shoot-off, and never during that final did I feel like I was enjoying it. It was always high pressure. I sadly nearly got to the point in the Sydney Olympics where I was far enough ahead that I started to think I'm going to win this again. And that was sort of the devil getting into your head. And then, of course, I held on to get into the shoot-off and then lost the sudden death shoot-off, probably against the guy who deserved to win it. In my mind, Richard Folds was the best shooter in the world then. But if the worst thing that ever happens to me in my Olympic career was winning a silver medal, I guess I haven't done too badly. But yeah, it could have easily been two gold medals, and it could have easily been I watched both finals from the other side. So I went to six Olympic Games and I competed, you know, made three finals. So I don't think I had a bad Olympic career. But yeah, if you're saying what's the favourite moment, gold beats silver all the time. Well, the word is competitive, because I've seen so many athletes just practice and train and practice and train, and they become really good world-class practice shooters. Then you take them to a competition and their practice results don't reflect their competition results. And I think you have to expose your athletes to as much competition as possible. And a lot of athletes don't like that, but unless you can learn to compete with a very high heart rate, you'll never be a good competitor. And unfortunately, a lot of people practice, 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 and they have a heart that's very slow. Then they're put into the first round of a competition and their heart goes crazy and their scores decline. The more times that I can take my athletes to compete and meaningful competitions, I find the better they become. And I don't think there's any shortcut. And I probably learnt that from watching the Italian team. I saw the Italians just shooting so much competition. And you've got to think, why are they better than us? And the reason was they were just exposed more. They weren't any different. They still had red blood in them when you cut them, but they were tougher. And I think a lot of people, including the Australians and probably the Americans and most of Europe, learnt what the Italians was doing was the right thing. Expose your athletes to competition is the shortcut to success. It's a lot of exposure to keep your composure under pressure.
Okay.
And I really think that is the key, because if you don't get used to competition, you know, it's something new, and you don't want to feel something new at the Olympic Games. And a lot of people try and hide from it. That's the difference maybe between the Olympic Games and everything else, because everybody in the street that you live in knows you're at the Olympic Games. But when you're at an ISSF World Cup or even World Championship, no one really knows except your close shooting fraternity. But at the Olympics, everyone in your country knows. And it does get into your head for that. Yeah, that's a long story. I better be careful what I say here. Back in 1998, I met a young American skeet shooter, Lauren. Obviously, Lauren and I fell in love, and she came and moved to Australia, but she was flying back and forth for America trying to shoot for them. And I think in the end, she just got sick of that, and she said, "Can I stay in Australia?" So yeah, I was happy to keep her. We took away an American skeet shooter out of their team, and she ended up shooting for Australia and come fourth at the Athens Olympic Games in 2004. But then we had children, and once we had children, her focus changed from shooting to being a mother. But now she's back coaching. She's been the high performance director of the Indian team and now the Qatar team. So she showed for a lot of women there is a possibility to move from being a competitor into the administration and coaching side, and then a step higher, I guess, as a high performance manager. So I think it's been good for a lot of other women in our sport to see Lauren saying, you know, there are opportunities for females in this sport. It's not just a male-dominated sport. And years ago, I think a lot of women used to think that. But I think Lauren has helped open the doors for a lot of people in this sport to show that women are equal to men in it. Yeah, it's another good question. As a coach, I feel really helpless. When you're sitting in the chair, standing behind your person in the final, there's nothing I can really do to help them. But as an athlete, I control my destiny, and I like that. I can't say you know, there's probably nothing in the world as a sports person that it's what it's like to compete at the Olympics, but to feel what they're going through and to know you've been a part of their journey, I think that's important. I get a lot of personal pride out of that, but I think it's also important to make it their journey and not your journey. And if they can go out there and win, the last thing I want to do is say, I made that person get that. I was glad I was a part of that, but I've had my time. I'm happy to be a passenger in their time.
Russel Mark there talking to Martina at the Asian Championships in Changwon last year. Now, of course, further down the road, we will have an episode dedicated to the trap women's event. But as a little teaser for now, here's a clip with London 2012 Olympic champion, Italy's Jessica Rossi, who shared a little insight into her pre-event process.
Beh, prima della finale cerco di isolarmi, di concentrarmi. Respiro tanto, la respirazione per me è molto importante e quindi cerco di entrare nel mio mondo, nel mio flow e cerco di entrare già bella centrata e cerco appunto di mantenerla durante tutta la finale, per cui sì, faccio prima un riscaldamento motorio ovviamente e poi dopo inizio il mio modo per concentrarmi.
There will be more from Jessica Rossi in our Trap Women's episode, but for now that brings this episode to a close. Of course, you can catch up with everything we've released so far on the road to Paris 2024.
Next time, we'll be looking at the 10-meter air pistol women's event with Zorana Arunovic and the world champion Jian Ranxin.
But until then, thank you for joining us and goodbye.
Goodbye.